Hello, everybody. Welcome to our first semi-final of Pro Tour Magic 2015. We are going to bring you all the action here in the booth. Rich Hagen sitting alongside Brian David Marshall and Louis Scott Vargas. It is Even Floch against Owen Turtenwald. There is the Slovak national champion in the blackborder.com shirt. Even Floch, there's Owen Turtenwald from Channel Fireball, and the players are ready to go. BDM, what is the matchup?
Well, this is blue-white control versus black-white mid-range, and it's really like Ivan Floch is playing a creatureless deck that really is just about boring his opponent to death.
Yeah, it's not even creatureless, it's just creatureless. It's win conditionless. It doesn't even have Elspeth. So his way of winning is basically Elixir of Immortality and just casting a giant Sphinx's Revelation every single turn. In reality, it finishes the games with Jace's Ultimate most of the time, right. But...
He gets to play your best remaining threat out of your deck.
Yeah, and Owen here has actually the start that he needs to win this, as depending on what Even has to answer it.
We have a turn two Pack Rat, but we also have an end of turn two Last Breath. The four life points for Owen Turtenwald, not relevant in the slightest. The no Pack Rat, hugely relevant for Even Floch.
Right. In untimed rounds, Floch could let his opponent start at 100.
Yeah, he could let his opponent start at any amount. He would just deck them. So this matchup in game one, I think, is a pretty good for Even because Owen has, a bunch of dead removal spells and Even has no targets for any of them. Owen's going to end up, really, really wanting to win this game one and having a much better post-board game.
Turtenwald attempts and Underworld Connections there, by the way, gets dissolved.
Yes, not allowed at all. So no card advantage engine for the non-blue-white player as Even draws a third island.
And one of the main features of Even's deck is that he's got four quickens to power out Supreme Verdicts, Divinations, and Planar Cleansings, which means that Obsidat, traditionally a really good threat against blue-white, is actually way more vulnerable. Quicken Supreme Verdict is actually a really good combo.
Right.
I can't tell you how long I've waited for Quicken to be good.
So Owen, it casts his third spell of the game. We've seen Pack Rat, that died. Underworld Connections, that didn't resolve. Now here's his third spell. It's Desecration Demon. That does resolve. And one thing we can be certain of, at least at this stage, is that Even Floch will not be tapping it down and putting plus one counters on it. So the Desecration Demon piles in for the first damage of the match against the Slovak national champion.
And Even could have answered it with a number of different things, but he's going to get a... Yeah, this is going to just be brutal here.
So there's Obsidat, Ghost Council for Owen.
Yeah, but it's just Even perfectly walked on into the Quicken Supreme Verdict to just wipe out both of these threats.
Here we go. Yep. Quicken.
Yep.
Card.
You hear Owen.
Supreme. Bye.
Wow.
And Owen didn't really have a choice, I don't think. Just sitting there on the one demon is just not going to be enough to finish the game before a giant revelation comes out to seal the deal.
Turtenwild, you see, holding two Banishing Light and Desecration Demon. That is Even Floch. There's Turtenwild with those three cards in hand right now.
And Even Banishing Light, which would normally be, good against blue-white, doesn't have very many targets because Even's not playing Detention Sphere.
Right. But he chooses to run Planar Cleansing, where a lot of the other decks are running Detention Sphere.
Yeah, that's the big choice here, the big difference. And Even really only has Jaces, but if he Jace minus twos and then it gets Banishing Light, that's perfectly fine.
Worth saying that although Even does not run creatures in the main deck, he does have Mutavault, which of course can become so. We're going to see Quicken again from Floch. This is with Desecration Demon number two coming down for Owen.
And even though you don't really want to dissolve Desecration Demons in general, I think Even should do it here, and this is why he does. He doesn't actually have an answer to it. He's got a Planar Cleansing, he's missing a third white, and Demon hits pretty hard. Owen is not particularly threat-dense, so taking the risk of just dying to a Demon is not very good.
A key pillar of the Even Floch deck has just entered his hand. It is a very unassuming little artifact, the kind of thing that all good players suggest really you shouldn't play terribly often in most formats. It's Elixir of Immortality, and this could be Even Floch's ticket to immortality.
Yeah, well, Even's going to sit back on that. He plays Divination, draws into his first Sphinx's Revelation. Now, does he have to get that elixir down on the table now? Like, he can never afford to let that card sit in his hand, can he?
Getting Thoughtseize is pretty awkward. It's tough to win if your elixir gets Thoughtseize and you've already cast some revs. Because Jace can win you the game. It's a little bit slow, though. So I think Even would rather play it. And because he's not anticipating tapping out this turn, he can just shuffle it back in to make sure it doesn't get Banishing Lighted. But even if it does, he can eventually unlock it off Planar Cleansing.
So there it is. 2, tap, you gain 5 life. Well, the 5 life can be very important, but shuffle it and your graveyard back in. You never deck yourself. You can revelation your deck as much as you want. And now here, just after the elixir comes down, is indeed Thoughtseize from Owen.
And that was a perfectly timed Thoughtseize. Owen drew it this turn, cast it to get rid of the revelation that that was going to basically end the game next turn, or at least put even in a very good position. A rev for 4 or 5 against an empty board is really tough to beat.
And even says, I tell you what, I'm just going to crack my Elixir of Immortality. I'll put that Sphinx's Revelation back into my deck, give myself more chance of drawing one of those. Because, as we say, BDM, you were talking with Frank Karsten at the start of the morning on the news desk set and said, look, give us a pointer at home. Right. When are things sort of over? And Frank said,
your opponent is lost in the woods, their team name, once you get the first Sphinx for 6. Although he was really specifically talking about the red matchup, but right. I think it applies. all the way across the board.
Yeah, I think if he even draws Rev and just casts it for 4 here, he's probably just going to win the game, just because Owen isn't actually pressuring him. Owen has 3 of those, you know, dead removal spells we mentioned in his hand right now.
Well, he's going to just cycle through Azorius Charm Planeswalker time.
First Planeswalker of the game.
And that comes in with 4, but instantly the dice moves to 2, and we see 2 land and a divination. It is the card draw spell for 3 mana that Floch chooses. 2 lands go away. Owen will use the end of turn to cast Hero's Downfall.
And it's vastly preferable to Hero's Downfall rather than put Banishing Lights into play, because they're just a liability. Against the Planar Cleansing, you know it's an even hand.
And you know the Planar Cleansing's there.
Yeah, so even is basically playing the game he wants to play right now.
Up at 17, about to draw bonus cards. We see a Syncopate in hand. He draws both a Divination and Sphinx's Revelation, the first one coming back, as it were. Owen's version of what can I find around the deck revolves around temples. You saw one last turn that he got to scry, put something to the bottom, but that, of course, cannot compete with the pure card draw of Floch.
You tweeted something earlier today when Matt Sperling scooped up his cards in a game against even Floch that, you know, I mean, they were still playing the game and even wasn't, you know, was going to eventually defeat him. And, you know, the game could have actually gone on for an hour. I mean, what is there a point where you're just like, I can't play this game anymore?
I mean, you basically never want to scoop in the top 8 of a Pro Tour until you're dead, because there's no time limit. You're not, you know, you always have a chance. But when your opponent's casting a Revelation for 10 every turn, sure. I think at that point, I mean, you have to think about your life equity. Like, you want to actually do other things with it at the time you have remaining in the day.
Blood Baron of Viscopa gets syncopated by even Floch.
And the turn before you cast the Rev, you'll basically counter almost everything, because you assume Rev will draw you a bunch of answers, and you want to spend, you know, as few mana as possible. Mm-hmm. So even not even content with casting a Rev for what, like 6 here?
So we go again with Jace, and we see, well, yeah, obviously.
I'll take the Supreme Verdict land pile over the Supreme Verdict pile.
One of the easier choices of Floch's weekend so far. Head back to Turtenwald. He's drawn Underworld Connections.
And that's, you know, basically the best card he can draw in this situation, especially since even does not have a direct answer to it, but even still going to just power through with a Rev. I mean, he could cast Planar Cleansing, but that's not really that thrilling.
Owen down, in air quotes, to 23.
Cool.
But again, really not about Owen's life total.
No, basically at no point is Owen's life total going to be like relevant to the outcome of the game.
Yep.
So I love how the Jaces just get...
Oh, it's just a double divination.
That's basically what it is.
Yeah,
he's just like, do it, throw it away. I can cast this Jace 9 times this game. Takes the dissolve pile.
Yeah, last breath and land goes away. The dissolve is obviously hard.
And if Owen doesn't play a big threat this turn, this is the turn I'd expect the revelation to happen, but... It looks like Floch is just content to keep trading one for one. I guess given that he found the dissolve and doesn't have just syncopate,
right.
This gives him just another turn to stop Owen's threats.
Cast Planar Cleansing to deal with Underworld Connections.
Oh, one for one. What's wrong with that?
Tuck.
Mutavault comes in. Even will fall to 15.
I think now might be the turn where he casts Revelation. I think 8 is enough to satisfy just about anyone.
He's very patient, though. We'll see. In
guess.
We go again.
I'm at 13.
Nope. No. You people, you're so impatient.
Pretty hard to turn down 8 cards. But Evan has managed to do it.
Put that back on top of your library.
Owen might just cycle Devour Flesh here. Basically use Devour Flesh to not draw Mutavault next turn. This is a pretty hopeless position for Owen.
Go.
And now that Evan knows Owen is basically drawing a dead card, well, Divination actually does give you a good reason to forestall the Revelation, because Evan's deck does have a lot of air in it, a lot of cycling cards, a lot of removal that's not going to do a whole lot right now. So casting the, you know, as big a Revelation as possible is kind of what you want to do.
Yeah, we had an earlier quote from Rich. He said the only thing control players like to do more than drawing cards is discard them.
Yeah, that makes sense.
In comes the Mutavault again, but this is not a series of relevant attacks. Perhaps most relevant is now we've got so many land on Flock's side of the board.
Is it time?
The 12th one is just heading down to the bottom.
It's
got to
be time, right?
The
I mean, there we go.
Nine.
Yep.
Nine.
And Owen is not someone who I'd expect to concede until the game's over. So,
gonna mentally exhaust his opponent by making him just play out every single action of this match.
Yeah, it's possible.
Are we gonna end up breaking out 99 bottles of beer at some point during this match?
I don't drink.
Did you even not find a land among those millions of cards?
No.
Oh, there
there we go.
I'm surprised that his hand hasn't been updated yet.
Oh, you are not kind.
More quickly, floor reporter, more quickly.
I mean, at this point, Evan's got all the divination or all the dissolves, like quickens plus wrath that can even kill Mutavault if he needs to. Like,
it's basically two-headed giant right now. It's turn 7. Both the blue-white control players have 6 land in play and a full grip of cards.
The only way Evan can lose right now is if that elixir gets Thoughtseize somehow. And even then, it's not a guaranteed thing because of Jace Ultimate.
Yep.
So here we go. Here's the discard. I'll tell you the entire starting hand he's about to get rid of.
He's going to keep the 4 dissolves. He's going to keep the rev. And now he has to keep his next... another...
another rev. And maybe a syncopate?
Syncopate's getting a little less good because of how many lands Owen has, but Evan has millions, so maybe Syncopate's fine. Just having all counters is not
last
bad.
Last breath for a random Mutavault.
The last breath answering the Mutavault actually would be my selection here.
So he's going to keep a hand, discard a hand. It's like a conspiracy card. Draw 2 hands. Pick
just
one.
Discard one of them, yeah. It's like he casts Memory Jar, but then just gets to keep 7.
I don't know if you guys are movie fans.
I've been known to watch a television experience now and again.
This reminds me of the bottomless chair scene from Casino Royale.
A lot of people refer to these as awkward silences, but I'm here to tell you it's actually a choice.
I'm going to discard these wraths, this planar cleansing.
Yeah, even just discarded a hand that was better than something that Owen could beat.
But, so, with a net plus 3 in the life total column here in game 1, Evan Flock leads Owen Turtenwald by 1-0.
Do you pick your discard hand based on maximum
tilting,
demoralization?
Like he keeps 7 lands and discards like in amazing cards. I suspect that would not be a good strategy, but it would be funny.
So, why don't we see what these two players might be up to after game 1, and potentially we've got quite a lot of in and out and shake it all about to do. Even Flock, here's his sideboard. Let's see what the options are. So, 4 Nyx Fleece Ram, 2 Last Breath, an Elspeth, Jace, Deicide, double Dispel, double Gainsay, and a couple of Archangel of Thune. So, Luis, why don't we start with you? What are your thoughts on what Flock might be doing here?
Flock doesn't actually have a ton that he really wants to bring in. Like, he can bring in Jace, he can bring in Elspeth, he can bring in Deicide, he can bring in more Last Breaths. But other than that, I mean, the matchup is so good game 1, and he's got so few dead cards game 1, that this is not really a matchup that improves much post-board. In fact, I mean, it improves for Owen post-board, and even Flock's deck doesn't even get that much better without caring about what Owen does.
Is Deicide something like where you're worried about Erebos? Like, so much of what he ends up doing revolves around resetting his life total?
Yeah, Deicide's quite good. I mean, it kills Erebos and it kills Underworld Connections, so that alone is enough to justify it.
So that's even Floch. Now, on the other side of the table, well, there are quite a lot of dead slots potentially and quite a lot of things to come in. Owen Turtenwald's sideboard looks like this. Three Duress, the Erebos God of the Dead.
Yes, single, yes.
Single Send Collector.
Yes.
Underworld Connections.
Yes.
Two Drown in Sorrow.
No.
No. Two Last Breath.
Probably not.
Three Doomblade.
Absolutely not.
Yeah, even I wouldn't sideboard those in. And two Deicide.
Yeah, and like BDM said with his chanting after each card, yeah, the first six cards come in, the Duresses, the Erebos, the Sync Collector, and the Underworld Connections for some combination of removal spells that Owen deems least dead.
Now, that sounded pretty miserable. I mean, deems least dead. That implies that there's quite a selection of dead to choose from.
Well, against a deck without Detention Spheres, Deicide's not good, and the Banishing Lights are a lot less good. So even has a particularly hard to sideboard version against for Owen, but this matchup still does get a lot better for Owen. Having Sin Collectors and Duresses and Thought Seizers means that he can, you know, pick apart Even's hand, stop Sphinx's Revelation, maybe take a Dissolve. And then Erebos plus the fourth Underworld Connections means that Owen actually has a good chance of drawing more cards than Even.
All right, give me an idea. If you had to numerically qualify the matchup pre-board and then numerically qualify the matchup post-board, what would those numbers be like?
I think pre-board it's something like 65 to 70% in Even's favor. And I think post-board, it's probably something like 55% in Owen's favor.
Oh, wow. Okay.
But interesting.
Those are rough guesses based on playing similar matchups.
Right, and that's based largely on the fact that just Owen has so many dead draws in that first
Owen took
game.
Out a bunch of ones on a 1 to 10 scale and put in a bunch of like 9s and 10s. So that's actually really good for him. Whereas Even is not really taking out, like he's taking out 4s for 6s, but that, you know, that doesn't really help a ton.
Right.
So
right.
It does swing the matchup a lot.
Coming into the Pro Tour, Luis, we obviously talk to the big teams, the big names, the regular faces on the Pro Tour. But it's also nice to get a sense of what I might call the ordinary Pro Tour player is thinking. The people who are there at the first time, the people who are back for their third PT out of a PTQ, who don't have access to a big team. And the narrative from them was very much coming in, Mono Black, we think, is pretty clearly the best deck. And that if we want to beat that, well, maybe black-white is a pretty good place to be because we get the advantage of Blood Baron as of Viscopa in particular, and obviously that's a big deal as well, and so on. I heard very little from any group coming in this weekend about blue-white control. Was that something that people thought wasn't going to be played a lot? Because to be fair, I didn't see much of it either.
Yeah, we did not expect to face a ton of it. We knew it was going to be there. It's still a good deck. But if I had to guess, like, how many times I would expect to play it in, like, the 10 rounds of Constructed, I would say, like, 0 or 1 times are the two most likely outcomes.
Hmm.
So, of our entire team, actually, Paulo Vitor Domodorosa is the only person who played it. Though he did go 7-2-1 in the Constructed part, so it ended up working out pretty well for him.
You see Owen Turtenwald there. He is looking at those 7 cards.
The Underworld Connections.
Yep, and a Mutavault. There's a Desecration
is
Demon
there. Is
that enough
to keep a hand?
This looks like a keepable hand. It's not a great hand. It's 2 spells and 5 land, but the Underworld Connections is one of your better spells, and Demon is a good threat. It's even actually good against even Flock's hand.
Yeah, even Floch has Temple of Enlightenment.
2 Last Breaths.
Hallowed
and I think maybe
Fountain.
A Supreme Verdict.
Yep, he's got 2 Last Breaths and a Supreme Verdict, which actually don't match up all that well, though. Looks like he may have just drawn a Deicide, which would be kind of what he's looking for here. Or though it might have actually been a Guild Gate. So something along those lines.
Deicide or Guild Gate.
So straight into action, the Mutavault.
New iPhone app coming out soon.
Yeah.
Mutavault already done some work on the life total front, but this time is needed on the mana side for that turn 3 Underworld Connections, which Floch can do nothing about.
And Owen might run away from the game very quickly here on Unanswered Connections. I mean, Owen's at this point not drawing any dead cards. All his spells are good. So, and even just on all reactive cards, no card draw, no answers to Connections. I mean, this is what the post-board games can kind of look like sometimes.
Right. And we know Owen will have the mana to operate all the cards he's drawing because he had a lot of lands in his opening hand.
Presumably, though, even sitting on the other side of the table already knows that that's the kind of thing that can happen against a deck like this. And he kept his opening hand, so was comfortable with that. So presumably,
here comes a Sin Collector.
Hello. Yep.
And a Duress on Legs is actually a lot better than Duress in this matchup in particular. Yeah, if you knew you were playing against a lot more blue.
Ability on the stack. Yeah, sure. I'm going to draw one card. Okay.
Hmm. 18. Why would he do that?
Um.
I guess he just wants more information about his own hand. Card he's going
to
select.
He wants to know whether his sync collector resolves first before drawing a card. Because he wants to play around syncopate as well. But even didn't have a syncopate last turn for connections, but no reason to not play around syncopate.
I'm at 17 right now. Nope.
Do you just take the planar cleansing here, which is going to be the only answer to your underworld connections?
At this point, I would assume that planar cleansing is the pick. I mean, there's two last breaths, and you're not finishing the game with your sync collector anyway.
Right.
So, and Supreme Verdict on Sync Collector is not a big deal, but Sync Collector is very good here. I mean, like I started to say before, you know, we started to see Even's hand. If you knew you're going to play against Blue White a lot more, Sync Collector is much better than Duress because it actually two for ones them, it forces them to deal with it. They have no blockers. But the fact that Duress is a lot better than other, you know, a wider range of matchups means you can't afford to play too many Sync Collectors.
So, Blue White pretty well positioned as it turned out for Even Floch. Obviously, he played it terrifically.
Yeah, they had, I believe, four players on their team, is what Frank said, playing blue-white. So he was the one who performed best out of all of them.
There goes the planar cleansing.
Go.
Underworld Connections does pressure planar cleansing a lot better than it does the Detention Sphere version. If that planar cleansing was a sphere, that Underworld Connections would have already been gone.
Last breath takes out the Sin Collector at the end of the turn there.
Yeah, no real reason not to at that point particularly. Obviously, there is a Mutavault still over there for Owen.
Yeah, but Floch has another last breath, and there's no way Owen's really going to overextend into Supreme Verdict now that he's seen it. He's content doing 2-4 damage a turn.
So what card does Floch want to see right now on top of his deck?
Not Rev, actually. You actually just don't want to draw Rev until like the middle to late game because it just gets duressed earlier or thought seized. You'd like to see like Jaces would be good or Divinations, all the like small card draw spells. You wouldn't hate seeing a Dissolve either. Though with Underworld Connections, that actually he probably just wants to see Deicide. That's probably his best card to draw. Just killing Underworld Connections at least puts them on even footing.
Desecration Demon. There you see it.
Floch's thinking.
Any opponent, in this case even Floch, can sacrifice a creature.
I think Floch was trying to sell that he had a counterspell there. I don't know how successful it was because Owen knows how likely that is. And Floch's like overlong pause, I think, may have given it away. I would not necessarily try it against all players in the Pro Tour.
Sometimes referred to as Hollywooding.
Yeah, Hollywooding is definitely the sort of thing that gets overused. Owen has built up a very nice hand in the last couple turns. I mean, drawing two cards a turn does that. But between, you know, Duress and Pack Rat, he's got, you know, credible other threats. He's got an Elspeth waiting. So at this point, Owen is doing pretty well.
So we see a Duress now from Owen Turtenwald.
Did you quicken Supreme Verdict here?
That is my guess, because you don't really want to just get hit by a demon. It hits so hard. So I think you want to quicken, you want a Verdict, and then you hope that Sphinx of Revelation is lurking in the top couple cards of your deck. But again, you didn't want to draw it earlier.
Because right now, Floch is down to land. We said at the start of the day that he just wants to keep on playing land turn after turn. He's going to be able to do that. It's whether he's going to be able to do anything else against an opponent who is drawing two cards a turn.
And Packrat will kill even Floch in just like 2 to 3 turns. So Even's going to need to draw a Supreme Verdict or a Planar Cleansing, or he's just going to be dead.
He would really prefer the Planar Cleansing at this point. He just doesn't want to have to deal with that Underworld Connections for much longer. Do you want to give us an idea of what, you know, now that we know exactly how Owen has sideboarded, what happened?
Yeah, Owen took out just a whole pile of removal spells, Banishing Light, Ultimate Price, Bioblight, Devour Flesh for Duress, Erebos, Sync Collector, and Underworld Connections. Just those the very clear anti-control cards he's got there. And that is a lot, you know, better sideboarding matchup-wise for Owen than Floch. I mean, if you look at Floch took out 2 syncopates, a quicken, and a mutavault, all cards which are perfectly fine for last breath, Elspeth, and Deicide, cards which are good, but again, not huge power level upgrades here.
Right. So Owen made a second rat at the end of Even's turn and is really able to start doing some damage here.
He's got 2 mutavaults on the board.
Yeah, and with double mutavault, the pack rats are actually just lethal next turn. So Owen, you know, he probably will just go for it if Even doesn't do anything on his turn.
Right. I don't know how many people who are listening haven't played with Pack Rat, but let's explain that to people. He can make another Pack Rat, put them both to 3-3, and then activate each Mutavault, even just not using them to attack, just animating them to make them into rats, and get in for 10. He just plays another rat, the cheaper route.
Yeah, the cheaper rat. And he can even do that without really risking a quicken supreme verdict too much here.
So in comes the team.
He's cracking for 14 here, which
yeah.
Which is going to add up. I mean, at this point, Owen, so now next turn, he can attack with the rats without attacking with mutavolts. Those are already lethal. Even has to have quicken, verdict, or planar cleansing.
Nope.
And then there we have it. The turn after that, Owen would threaten lethal with mutavolts, even if the rats got dealt with. So even needed a pretty incredible sequence of cards to win that.
So there you have it. Even Floch won, Owen Turtenwald won. And basically, all even Floch got to do was play some very pretty lands, and it was Owen Turtenwald doing all the card drawing. Card drawing is good, boys and girls.
What does an opening hand for even look like that is able to win after sideboard?
He basically wants Divination. That's one of his better cards. Syncopate, I wouldn't be surprised if Syncopates came back in. They're just a lot more effective on the play. And you know, he wants to be able to hit his land drops for, again, every single turn. So I think something like 4-land Divination and a counterspell or two would be a great hand. A Last Breath to kill a pack rat. He's very vulnerable to the, you know, the turn on thoughts he's turned to a pack rat. And here we see the Syncopates coming back in, actually. Or, you know, we have an overhead camera view as well. And, yeah, Syncopate does get a lot better when you're the one who's laying lands first. So Even's opening hands are a lot less dynamic than Owen's. Owen's, you know, are like thoughts he's in a pack rat, thoughts he's in a connection, duress or whatever. Even's just like, I hope nothing happens. I hope it gets to turn five and there's nothing on the board.
But even a hand of thoughts he's duress that doesn't have, you know, a huge follow-up from Owen is pretty devastating against Even.
Yeah, I think that Even is looking at, you know, getting disrupted basically once or twice a turn, you know, in the first five turns or so.
Well, it's all been about card draw so far. In game one, it was about the Divinations and Sphinx's Revelations of Even Floch. But game two was all about the card draw of this card from Owen Turtenwald, Underworld Connections, the enchantment, the rare from Return to Ravnica. And as you can see, oh, Phyrexian Arena, that was such a lovely, lovely card. Can see why Underworld Connections so popular. 29 Grand Prix Top 8 decks. That's done its work for the pro community, it's fair to say. And, of course, a reliable source of devotion because it has two black mana in its symbols, making it a crucial component of mono-black devotion decks.
It's funny. I feel like people maybe even almost started playing it because they were looking for cards with black pips.
Yeah, I think that, you know, once we saw the aftermath of Pro Tour Dublin, where we saw, you know, mono blue devotion in the finals, both, you know, on both sides, people were like, oh, devotion, that's a good thing. We should look for cards that power devotion. And this is a pretty devastating way to do that.
Yeah, and then, you know, we Pack Rat came out of that event also. You know, we saw Yamamoto playing Pack Rat in the deck. And then, you know, it didn't take long. In fact, Owen, like a week later, pretty much was, you know, powering up his rats with Underworld Connections.
Yeah, we actually saw Brian Brandewin win Grand Prix Nashville with mono black, just for, you know, Underworld Connections.
Right, one week later, and then it was like, I guess, 2 weeks later that Owen's on that deck as
In Albuquerque, yeah.
Yeah.
One other thing there, we noticed in the last quarterfinal that William Jensen had Underworld Connections but was really running out of life. Flavor on Underworld Connections. If you're looking for it, it's available. The question is how much you're willing to pay in this matchup. Owen can pay as much as he likes because life is a complete resource for him. For, you know, he is never going to be sitting at three going, dare I go to two and go into shock range or whatever. So if he can get it down, absolutely huge. As we see Owen shuffling up the CFB sleeves there. And there you see him, the former player of the year. And now your World Magic Cup captain for Team USA. Luis, will you manage to get to any of the WMCQs?
As of now, I'm not planning on going to any. Unfortunately, the one that Channel Fireball is running overlaps with a camping trip I had planned. So I will not be captaining from that perspective. But I haven't actually looked at what my schedule looks like a little further out. So there's a chance I make it to one of them.
Well, you've actually qualified through the WMCQ in the past.
I won the one in Oakland 2 years ago. Actually beat Tom Martel and Shahar Shenhar, who then became the captain of the Israeli team the year after. But that aside, yes, I was able to play on the team with Brian Kibler, Joe Pinocchio, and Alex Bynek. We had a good finish. We finished in the top 16. You can see Kibler getting bonfired out all over the internet.
You could see me walking away from the table.
That is
in the
a great little gift, you know.
Like,
yes. So even Floch is looking at his seven for what will be the deciding game of our first semi-final here at Pro Tour Magic 2015. We see a Sphinx's Revelation, a Jace, we see a Divination, some lands. Looks like he's going
to
keep.
That sounds close to the hand and you described as being very good for him.
Yeah, I mean, he's not looking for anything particularly special, but...
So away we go for game number three, and it will be Floch on the play. He opens up with Guildgate. And turn one, Duress. What do we see?
Take it apart.
We know that there's Planeswalker, the Rev, Divination plus three.
There's just Divination, Divination, and Divination, basically.
Yeah.
Do you take the first Divination?
It's really going to depend on what Owen's follow-up is here, since taking the Divination is attractive because, you know, the cheapest option, and it'll come out on turn three. But Jace is more powerful and more annoying, so if Owen doesn't have a good way to answer that, he might just take the Jace. And if Owen thinks he's not really going to put enough pressure on it, the Rev might actually be the pick. Though, I would be surprised if Owen didn't anticipate having a follow-up to Rest or Thought Seize before Rev came out.
I see that he does have an Underworld Connections in hand there.
Yeah, Owen's hand looks pretty good, too. Any hand with Underworld Connections and Duress is already pretty good.
So Jace will go away. We go to turn two for Even Floch. He's drawn Planar Cleansing, which one day, quite a long way in the future, may turn out to be good. Blood Baron of Viscopa.
And things are pretty much rolling the way Even wants them to. Nothing's happening yet. He knows that Underworld Connections is coming out, you know, or at least assumes that, but he doesn't have a counterspell, so he might as well cast Divination.
19.
Down to 19. And
Owen drawing a Lifeband has changed his plan.
So let's have another look.
It's been amazing to me how good Lifeband Zombie has turned out to be against decks where it can virtually never take anything out of someone's hand.
Yeah, I mean, the opportunity cost of playing Lifeband Zombie is just very low. It's a 3-1 unblockable in, like, the fail case. And
right.
That's still quite good.
Yeah, it's a card that you marked out for us earlier in the weekend, BDM, before we came in the preview. Said, look, I think this is going to be very good. But as you say, the fact that sometimes it's been blank and it's still being good is interesting.
Well, and the card, even when it's not being played, exerts tremendous pressure on the format, right? I mean, it certainly constrains maybe some of the deck ideas you might have. You're like, oh, well, they have Thoughtseize and Lifebane Zombie. What happens to me?
Yeah, I mean, there's one of the reasons that Kibler has not had his most thrilling year is that, you know, the decks he likes to play are really, really negatively impacted by Lifebane Zombie. And I, for one, know he's going to be very happy when it rotates out.
Which happens in October.
Yep, the next Pro Tour will not feature any Lifebane Zombies, barring a very odd reprint in Dawns of Tarkir, which I would be incredibly surprised to see.
Right. No Pack Rats, no Lifebane Zombies, no Underworld Connections.
No Sphinx's Revelations.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I think that a rotation is going to be pretty great.
And also, we've been in a rotation currently where, because Devotion has been such a big thing over the last year, that's very much about mono as far as possible in terms of colors. And, of course, Khans of Tarkir, we now know, is very much not only about gold cards, but about wedges of enemy color. So you're going to see an awful lot of powerful cards taking you a long way away from mono.
Yeah, so Owen has some interesting decisions here. He knows about Planar Cleansing, or he doesn't know about Planar Cleansing. He knows it's in, you know, Even's deck, and he doesn't want to overcommit to it. But because Even drew an Azorius Charm, Owen is a lot happier just, you know, playing more cards out.
It's Desecration Demon up next. Yep. Even at the end of turn, will cycle Quicken.
The old Quicken into Quicken.
Yeah, and he's quickly going nowhere with that. Desecration Demon hits pretty hard. I would expect Even to play a Scryland here and likely be looking at casting Planar Cleansing the next turn. Owen gets a hit in for six, but because Planar Cleansing kills everything, it means that Owen doesn't really want to cast another creature right now, or even Underworld Connections. Basically, the blue-white deck is forced to deal with every one of Owen's threats already, so adding two to the board is not usually what you want to do.
We see that Owen's also drawn a Blood Baron of Viscopa.
So Owen taking the opportunity because he's not, you know, likely to be casting a whole lot here. He could cast a Lifebane, but he's not certainly not casting Underworld Connections. He's willing to just get in for eight and then make Even tap out next turn and then next turn play some more threats.
Cards.
So Owen Turtenwald, the number 5 ranked player in the world, he could go a lot higher over the next couple of hours. Jeremy Dezani, of course, will be your new number 1 ranked player next week because he is the player of the year.
So Owen chooses to just not play anything this turn.
Yeah, and even decides not to cast Quicken. He might be setting up Planar Cleanse and Quicken, but I'd be really surprised if he could just take 8 here. I think taking 8 this next turn puts him so close to just Mutavault range that he may want to play a land and a Planar Cleansing. He could rev for 3. That is also a pretty viable alternative. Especially because of Quickens, Owen might not attack with Mutavault out of fear of Supreme Verdict.
Right.
So getting hit down to 6 by Demon and then casting rev for 3 is pretty good. So I actually kind of like just playing land, saying go, letting Owen hit you for 6, and then doing nothing. And then if Owen plays another threat, it gets Planar Cleansing. And then it sets up potentially a Quicken Planar Cleansing the turn after. But Even's played through the situation so many times that I'd be willing to go with whatever he settles with here. Mutavault showing why the monocolor decks are so good. That's another card which will relieve some of the pressures when it's gone. Mm. Right now, the pressure is to play a monocolor deck because you do get to play Mutavaults, and Mutavault's just an amazing threat. Multicolor decks just don't get to play as many Mutavaults or even at all, depending on what the colored symbols look like in your deck.
He just decides, let's get rid of that demon right now. I don't want to risk a duress.
Yeah, duress would be quite bad for even there. And Owen missing a land drop now. So Owen, he can play something, but it's not going to be quite as good as a rev. I kind of like just playing a threat here. I think Owen has kind of held off on Underworld Connections every time so far in favor of playing Lifebane, in favor of playing Demon. I think Underworld Connections just does not outrace Sphinx's Revelation, so playing cards that can attack Even's life total do end up, you know, being the most effective. So the debate here is really Blood Baron or Underworld Connections. You could also play Lifebane and hit for two with the Mutavault, but I think in general having Blood Baron in play is enough better, especially since it's the more mana intensive play, setting up a turn later where you can cast Lifebane and another spell in the same turn.
How much unknown information is in Even's hand right now that he decides to go with Underworld Connections?
And he's actually looking for a duress most of all, but if he misses on duress, a land drop is fine. And Temple of Silence is actually a pretty good draw for Owen. Even really wants to draw an untapped land here to cast a rev for 4, though.
Cool.
Leaves it on top. So Floch knows that something...
There's your untapped land.
Yeah. Though he does have a dissolve, he could be willing to try to take another turn. The problem is if Owen goes duress, Even's kind of forced to dissolve it. And then Even basically cast a 3-drop instead of casting a 7-drop, which is pretty rough, though. Even has been reluctant to cast revs for anything less than 10 so far. Yep. So it looks like he's on
the rev next turn.
Patience all the way from Even Floch.
You can hear a little bit of the anticipation in the crowd.
17.
And Owen keeping Thoughtseize on top. I mean, he kept it so fast that my guess is that it was a Dresser Thoughtseize and it ended up being a Thoughtseize, just because that's just by far the best card he could have in the situation.
So here it is.
And that has to get dissolved here?
Yeah. Given the way Even played this last turn, I would expect dissolve to come out. I mean, he could cast rev for 3, but that does not seem as enticing as just casting a dissolve. And then assuming the rev will buy you a turn of whatever of safety from whatever threat Owen plays, which will likely end up being Blood Baron here, though, sure. Again, he could still... Well, Mutavault attack for 2 is less good into potentially open Last Breath mana.
Floch took no time at all to leave the top card right there.
Yeah, he had scryed it last turn at the temple, and the situation had not changed enough.
So there is Blood Baron of Viscopa. And we go back to Even Floch. He's up to 7 mana. We know he can get to 8. There's a Supreme Verdict that he's just drawn. He passes again.
And he's not looking at casting Quicken because he wants to combo Supreme Verdict.
16.
No. Owen at 16 now.
And Owen's got a couple options here. He can hit with the Blood Baron. He can hit with some number of Mutavaults. Quicken, if he's hitting with his Mutavaults, this Quicken is just going to kind of destroy him.
Yes, he is.
Oh, here we go. Quicken from Floch.
And that does not look like a speculative Quicken.
Verdict.
Oh, Floch just... Well, that was way too hasty, I think. I think Floch actually wanted to cast Planar Cleansing there. He would have killed the Underworld Connections as well. So... I think he was kind of locked into his plan.
Right.
And just, you know, ran it out.
He drew the Floch.
Yeah, he was flocked into his plan. He drew the cleansing and just immediately snapped off his
Supreme Verdict. And now he might have to just cast the cleansing here.
Yeah, and I think casting the cleansing here is very reasonable, but Owen's follow-up Elspeth would actually be pretty good. At this point, I actually kind of like just casting a Rev for 5. You hit a land drop, you end up setting yourself up a lot better.
So let's see if we can what those 5 cards, the reset button for Floch, going to turn out
to
be.
The chat's completely right, by the way. Planar Cleansing doesn't kill Mutavault, so he had to cast Supreme Verdict.
Oh, sure. There you go.
Yeah, that worked out much better for him.
15.
Nope. See, and that Rev for 5 was pretty good. It hit into an Elixir and a couple of Azorius Charms and a Jace, so no second Sphinx of Revelation, but Floch's not going to need it quite yet.
Yeah.
This Planar Cleansing is going to be pretty good, though. Owen wants to get it out of Floch's hand so he can play Elspeth.
So he's playing the Underworld Connections to sort of force Ivan's hand as far as the Planar Cleansing?
Owen can't afford to slow play anymore. I mean, he's losing the game to giant Revs at this point. Revs outrace Connections just so quickly that he's got to just try to get Elspeth out and try to end the game. It's going to be difficult, but... You know, even cycling the second connection is just kind of makes Floch really, really eager to use that Planar Cleansing.
Right.
Even more eager than we were. But this time, you know, correctly.
Were you surprised that Owen attacked 2 Mutavaults in there, or does he just not have a choice?
It's tough because he knows that Rev's coming, so he can't really, again, he can't really afford to take his time. When you have more information about their hand and you... And, you know, you've made the game fast enough that Ivan's constricted on mana. That's different. But in this sort of game, you really can't afford to be patient. You just have to go for it.
And there you see him.
See?
Planar Cleansing and then tap the last mana to play the Elixir.
Dear Lord, that turn was brutal. Oh, here's a Divination. I'm up a card. Here's a Planar Cleansing. That was 3-for-1. Oh, now here's an Elixir. Thanks. Your turn.
Oh, here comes Elspeth, though.
Mm-hmm.
And so Floch doesn't have the revelation to seal the deal here, and Elspeth is a pretty fast clock, but it's still looking, I think, decent, especially since Jace does do a number on Elspeth. You've got all the tokens become 0/1s into the Jace plus.
Mm-hmm.
Yep, my turn.
Yep.
But Owen does have a plan. Let's see what Ivan can do. Elixir, of course, will gain 5, and that's what he's going to do right now.
He's doing that actually during his upkeep.
Yeah, he wants to increase the chances of basically drawing Revelation, though he wouldn't be unhappy with a Planar Cleansing right now.
There you see the two players. No sign from their demeanor who's ahead or behind.
I think Owen is feeling like he's pretty heavily disadvantaged here. He's got nothing else in his hand besides a Bile Blight, which is one of his worst cards in the deck. He just has to leave it in because he doesn't have enough cards to board out. He's really just hoping this Elspeth goes all the way, but it's going to be tough. I mean, Floch's going to see, like, 10 more cards before he has to, you know, actually do something between the Jaces and the Azorius Charms.
Yep.
Yes, that does sound bleak for Owen, as we see Supreme Verdict come into hand for even Floch.
So I mean, can he go Supreme Verdict and then activate Jace for its minus ability?
Looks like that's the plan, yeah. Though, you do end up losing Jace to Mutavault if you do that.
Do you want the 2 land, or do you want the Quicken? I'll have the Quicken, because that draws me a card anyway.
The Quicken actually makes this plan a lot better, because now Jace is safe from Mutavault, so Quicken is actually one of the better cards to turn over. Because now Owen just doesn't get a chance to sneak past Supreme Verdict. We'll see the same thing as last time.
If you lose 3 lands in one game to Quicken...
Yeah,
that's gonna wake you up at least one middle of the night.
And Owen drawing another one of his bottom 5 cards in Banishing Light here.
Okay. Here we go.
Yeah, I mean, he's not feeling excited. You could just hear it in his voice, but he doesn't really have much of a choice here.
Sure. Quicken to draw.
Yep.
Unbelievable. But making that card look terrific. Banishing Light takes out the Jace.
And let's start again with some more tokens. But Floch, again, look at that. 11 land in play now. Has a 12th ready to go. Up they come. You just got rid of a Jace? Okay, I'll have another one to trump your soldiers.
I like how he just puts two dice on it immediately.
And then Sphinx's revelation.
Owen's got one turn to draw Thoughtseize and force Ivan into casting. Only a revelation for 5. Otherwise, it's going to be a revelation for 10 or 11, and that's going to be a lot harder to come back from.
Tough, tough spot for the former player of the year, Owen Turtenwald. There's even Floch. Lays that next land. What can Owen find?
It's like quicksand. The more you struggle.
Yeah, it's just a land there. Two at Jace to try and kill it off. And one heading your way.
Do you Azorius Charm one of the two coming at Jace? Keep Jace alive?
I think that's actually pretty reasonable. I mean, you basically casting Azorius Charm as a Jace with one loyalty, which isn't super exciting, but at least keeps the Elspeth somewhat contained. Though Elspeth's getting close to ultimate. Once Elspeth ultimate, the Jace minus one ability or plus one ability doesn't really do much. So. It is looking like we're heading for, Floch in a best of 5 match. So the good thing is he plays very quickly.
He does.
And the way you can tell that is he does not have a ton of draws during this list.
But I hadn't put it in that context yet and may need to take a break in between the semis and the finals.
Floch feeling pretty good. He has to be worried also if he casts his Azorius Charm here. He really opens himself up to getting his Revelation Thoughtseize and not being able to draw cards off it. So I think the safer play, even though it's good to cast Azorius Charm and save Jace, I think the slightly safer play is just to do nothing and rev for 4 or 5 in the worst case scenario, which is Owen having Duress. If Owen doesn't have a Duress, you're just so likely to win this game that there's no reason to risk it over a Jace.
Yep.
And we've seen over and over that he's just super patient. He never pulls the trigger unless he really has to. Although then again, that planar cleansing moment was pretty swift.
Even technically doesn't have a way to stop Elspeth from going ultimate. Not that that's actually, just going to end the game right now, but it is something to be concerned about.
Yep. We're just going to dig through 3 Azorius Charms here.
Huh. Lifelink, lifelink, lifelink. All right.
No, not what happened there.
No, most certainly not.
So Quicken goes to hand, and yes, we didn't expect that to be a massive deal this weekend. But as you say, BDM, he's really making Quicken look very, very good.
And Owen now...
Will Owen ultimate here?
He puts even in the in the position to have to do something, though. Even's at 16. If Owen ultimated, he would attack for 18 and even would be able to rev out of range. So you lose your Elspeth there, and you don't have a source to make tokens in case of a Wrath. I don't know if ultimating does exactly what you need it to do. The problem is if you don't ultimate, even doesn't even have to cast Rev this turn. He can just do something else instead. So
he does go ultimate. So gets an emblem.
So right now, we're lethal.
Yeah.
3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18.
And looks like Quicken may continue to wipe the board since Quicken Supreme Verdict can let even cast an even bigger Sphinx's Revelation here.
There's Quicken.
Draws a redundant Supreme Verdict.
Yeah.
And now Owen has an Elspeth emblem with nothing to go with it. And even in the best position possible, playing your 15th land or whatever, and you're passing with Revelation in hand.
Only 14th?
And Packrat, despite how good it is just not going to match up well against this. Even's going to draw so many cards right now. He's going to draw 11 cards and then be able to cast a 11? Supreme Verdict on his turn.
I like everyone was like 11, which sounded like translated to English is do you concede?
Yeah.
Disgusting.
Marvelous. Oh, marvelously disgusting.
Yes.
There we are. We're in agreement.
Ah. And Planar Cleansing even has the additional bonus right now of giving even a Jace off that Banishing Light.
Oh,
so.
My gosh.
Just let me look at my 15-card sideboard. Oh, wait, that's my hand.
And that's what he's going to do. He's going to Planar Cleansing, and then he's going to draw 2 more cards.
Yeah, he doesn't have to discard enough
Oh,
yet,
he doesn't.
So.
He doesn't.
Up one.
Oh, he's decided to use Jace's win condition.
Yeah, and also this way he doesn't, doesn't have to discard too many cards. He already has to discard a bunch, but he's just good to keep, Last Breath, basically no targets now that Elspeth Emblem is around.
One more needs to go. It was a land. Yeah, you can go ahead.
Yeah, and unfortunately for Owen, he, I don't believe, can win this game with, under normal means. Something very extraordinary would have to happen.
Right. Well, even the business, this is referred to as a sucking chest wound.
Yes.
Syncopate your Elspeth Sun's champion. Go away.
Go.
Owen has to pass.
The rub-in divinations here. I mean, you still want to hit your land drop, so.
Oh, and there's the Sphinx's rub. I mean, the problem, he's so many lands out of his deck.
Yeah.
At this point.
Well, he's getting very close to actually going infinite, where you can rev an elixir every turn and just every turn, do something.
Well,
and now.
I have it at 14. Did you take damage somewhere?
Looks like a slight irrelevant life total discrepancy.
You say 11. Yeah, I had you at 112.
By the way, people playing in FNM, top tip, you're allowed to concede. Very good friend of mine playing a deck, a bit like Floch's in FNM. Took about half an hour of the first game to win. Opponent went to concede. He went, wait, come back, friend. And then the guy sat down and played some more of game one until he actually killed him, as we see, Supreme Verdict. You can...
If you're the type of person who plays this deck, you really want to keep playing.
Yeah.
You want to see how many times you can second
your
deck.
There's the handshake.
There's the hand flow. Yes.
There you have it. Owen Turtenwald is gone. Even Floch of the Slovak Republic. He has claimed his country's captaincy, as has Owen Turtenwald. You could see the two of them battling out for the World Magic Cup come December. But right now, even Floch advances to the Pro Tour Magic 2015 final. Congratulations to him. Well, there we go, boys and girls. It was all about card draw, and it turns out that there's one card on that side that draws cards, and there's all the cards on this side that draws cards. And that was pretty much what happened.
And possibly the most significant card draw spell in Even Floch's deck was Quicken.
Yeah, Quicken did a lot of work that match.
He destroyed so many lands with Quicken. It was kind of amazing.
Yep, it was like, well, you've got all Mutavaults. That's lovely for you. But it turns out I'm going to reach out on your turn.
That deck has so many of my favorite do-nothing cards. Yeah. I really do love it.
I mean, like an actual quarter of the deck is just cards that draw cards.
So would you go as far as to say it was a rout, that match?
No, I wouldn't say. I mean, Owen certainly showed, a dominating performance in game two.
Yeah, games one and two were very close. Game three was close until that, that one Supreme Verdict is when the tide turned.
Okay. The players are done. That means there is a space waiting for Jackson Cunningham and Pierre Mondon. We'll be back very soon with that semifinal. But why don't we head it back to the news desk and Marshall Sutcliffe.
Hey, guys. Welcome back to the news desk here at the PT. Marshall Sutcliffe. I've got Zach Hill with me and... pretty decisive. What do you make of that last match?
Yeah, I mean, I was talking to Z about it. I mean, Owen's deck was doing what it needed to do, get underworld connections in early, start drawing cards, but planar cleansing was an absolute blowout. Those instant speed rats were absolute blowouts. They mean that even Owen's trump cards aren't trump cards. So Floch did what he needed to win, and he's advancing to the finals.
You surprised?
I can't say that I am. I think that the blue-white control deck was very well positioned in that matchup. I think a thing that's awkward is the black-white deck doesn't actually have enough cards to side out like it wants, so it has to keep in some number of Bile Blights, which, can do stuff against Mutavault, can do stuff against Elspeth's tokens, but is essentially a blank card. Only one Sin Collector in the board. So it's not as though it's a bad or unwinnable matchup, but definitely I felt that Floch was favored, and that's exactly what happened.
Okay, why don't we take a look at our bigger picture here. We've gone through a decent amount of the tournament now. In the semifinals, we have our first finalist, Even Floch. He moves into the finals bracket and awaits his competitor. We are going to be finding that out very shortly here as the players are going to be moved over into the feature match area and seated. Pierre Mondon from the United States. Mm-hmm. He's an Ohio area player, correct?
Yeah, a longtime Ohio area player. Has a GP win, a couple other GP top eights, and this is the first big finish on the Sunday stage. Really awesome deck that he brought to the table. Jun Planeswalker's deck with four main deck copy of Read the Bones. Very, you know, pretty rogue choice, but it served him well this weekend.
You take a look at Pierre there as he gets set to go. He's played in seven Pro Tours now, and already banked a top eight, not too bad. He's somebody who has played Magic for quite a while, though he's got 33 lifetime pro points. That's usually indicative of somebody who's been around.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, none of the big necessarily high-profile finishes beyond those Grand Prix top eights, but that means he's finished, you know, relatively high up in the field, still on the rise, and this is going to really catapult his career.
Yeah, absolutely. So a big congrats to him for even making it this far, but he's got a little ways to go here. If he wants to be our champion, he is going to be up against Jackson Cunningham from Canada. He's from Vancouver. Of course, you know, we don't want to put too big of a label on him, but he is a very famous Magic player's younger brother. He's Jeff Cunningham's younger brother.
Yeah, and I mean, we had Jeff here, I guess he was talking about
I chatted with him over on the easy chairs.
Yeah, and I mean, so Jackson, you know, first event, first Pro Tour, one event, one top eight. It's pretty incredible, but with a pedigree of somebody like Jeff's backing you up, teaching you how to prepare, and crucially, I think, acclimating you to what it's like to play on Sunday, I'm wondering if, you know, Jackson's nerves are going to be, you know, a lot more calm than somebody else in his positions might be.
Yeah, I learned a lot from that chat with Jeff about how they went about it. They were very regimented. You know, they know each other incredibly well, being brothers, and that means that they can cut out a lot of the overhead, right? Like, they just know exactly how to communicate with each other in the most efficient way, and they were spreadsheets and data analysis, and they were really going deep on this thing. Additionally, Jeff was pushing Jackson. You know, Jackson said, my goal's to day two. It's my first PT. You know, it's like he's got to get used to the new environment. It's a big thing. It's like you got to kind of acclimatize yourself to what's going on. And Jeff said, no. He's like, that's not good enough. He's like, we're aiming higher than that. And
really?
Yes, and they have made it, in fact, all the way here to the semifinals. Jackson playing for a spot in the finals. Why don't we take a look at the matchup from a deckless perspective here, Zach? Let's look at Pierre's deck. He is playing the Jund Planeswalkers list. Now, Yuki Ichikawa was playing a Jund Planeswalkers list, but this one's a little different.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, we see on Yuki had four copies of Elvish Mystic. I believe Mondon only has three, but the big difference is that Ichikawa had four copies of Nissa the Worldwaker. Mana does not have any of those. In his place, like I was talking about, he has four copies of Read the Bones and two main deck Rakdos Return. Now, what that means is his deck is positioned extremely well against mid-range and control decks, does not have as much weaponry against aggro, and that's exactly what he's up against. But, you know, that being said, he's still got the package of Sylvan Caryatid and Courser of Kruphix that we saw dominate Pro Tour Journey into Nyx. So if he's able to keep those cards on the battlefield, it's quite a potent weapon against aggro decks as well.
Yeah, this is an interesting list, not one that we've seen a whole lot of yet. This is a relatively newcomer to the standard scene. We've seen Jund Monsters for quite a while, but this is a little bit of a different take. This sort of reminds me almost of we used to call them the Super Friends list, but this one, these friends are a little more sinister than the old ones.
Well, and what they all do quite well, though, is get around Lifebane Zombie. One of the reasons we saw a move away from cards like Pelucranos, cards like Reaper of the Wilds, is that those get hit with Lifebane. They sit in your hand and Lifebane all over the place because the mid-range black decks. So kind of an interesting metagame move, an interesting read of the environment, paid off really well for Mondon today.
Now, on the other end of the spectrum, we have Jackson Cunningham's list. It's a lot different. It's much cleaner, much simpler. It's an aggressive green-white build. Talk to us about this list.
I mean, basically, this deck tries to kill you as quick as possible while offering enough resilience to survive into the mid-game. See an amazing, powerful curve. Experiment 1, Sunblade Elf, Soldier of the Pantheon. At the 2, you've got Voice of Resurgence, Fleecemane Lion, 3, Boonsader, Smiter. I'm going up the curve because that's what this deck does. Basically just tries to put a threat on the battlefield every turn from turn 1 to 4, push it over the edge with a card like a Johnny or Boonsader. Banishing Light is a removal. Amazingly straightforward deck, but very resilient. I really like this choice for the tournament.
This is going to be an interesting one to watch, both from a deck perspective, you know, how this matchup plays out, but also from the player's perspective. Both of their first Pro Tour top eights, I saw both of them when I was walking out in between rounds there, and they looked nervous. I went up to Pierre and I said, "Hey, Pierre, how you feeling?" or whatever. He said, "I'm pretty nervous." You know, so I think that, like, once they get the jitters out, I think we're going to see some really hard-hitting magic being played. But it might take a little while for these players to sort of adjust to the whole. I mean, the stage, the lights. They know everybody's watching. Like, it can really affect you.
Well, I mean, yeah, and even stuff like hearing the roar of the crowd. I mean, there's a packed room full of people watching you play, and of course, you know, thousands of players around the world. That's not an easy pill to swallow. So no. I think, you know, you're absolutely right. We're going to see the matchup with the Magic cards, and then we're going to see the matchup with the players. And I really do feel like the player is able to best hold it together is going to have a significant edge in this match, where even one mistake could cost the entire possibility of the title.
Yeah, especially if you're looking at it from like Jackson Cunningham's perspective, where he's playing an aggressive deck, and aggressive decks are very skill intensive, and they're very demanding in the sense that they punish mistakes harder than most other decks. And that's going to be a big issue if Jackson, you know, can get those nerves kind of worked out. You know, one thing that we see a lot from players in this situation is they say, "I just want to start playing." Right, they're just like, just get me in there, and once the magic cards start being put down, I'll get into my groove, I'll be in my element, and I won't think about this other stuff. It's when they're sitting there, you know, out in the feature match area watching other people play or thinking about the things that are going through their head, that's when it really can kind of get at them.
Well, another thing that can be just torturous is when you see the opponents that you're playing against, and they've got an entire team deconstructing how sideboarding works. They're all sitting around, they're all discussing every play. If you're not from one of these super teams, basically what's happening is you are trying to figure out with maybe a buddy or two of yours, maybe you're in the crowd trying to get your mind off what's going on, but you know, you're confronted with the difference between, you know, these really established longtime teams and your sort of up-and-comer rising stardom.
Yeah.
That can be intimidating. On the other hand, it can be a pretty big David and Goliath moment for you to say, look, like, I don't need all this, you know, I don't need this infrastructure around me. I'm good. I know my deck. I'm going to take down the title.
Yeah. All right. Looks like we're ready to head down to the feature match area right now for the second semifinal match here from Pro Tour Magic 2015. Let's send it over to the booth where Luis Scott Vargas, Brian David Marshall, and our own Rich Hagen await.